Welcome to Worship with Messiah Online. We're glad you're with us today. Just a few announcements before we begin worship. MFAM, our theater ministry, will be presenting the musical Seussical, based on stories told by Dr. Seuss, on the weekends of July 28 and August 4. There will be several shows each of those weekends, and tickets are still available. You can find those online. Jim Harder, our executive director, will be retiring effective July 31. On Sunday, July 30, we'll have a reception for Jim here on site after each worship service, after both the 8:30 and the 10:15 services. Also, in August, beginning on August 9, I'll be leading what we're calling our No BS, that's No Bible Study discussion groups, on Wednesday nights. Again, beginning August 9, we'll meet at 7 p.m. on the South Lawn. Everyone is invited to come, and we'll just have some open discussion around a topic that we'll identify that night, and then just talk about for a while. So I hope you'll join us for that. And now we'll begin worship in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Do you?
Let's pray. Lord God, your mercy delights us, and the world longs to experience your love, your grace, and your forgiveness. Hear the cries of all those in need, and inspire and strengthen us to love you and to love our neighbors with the love we receive through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, in whose name we pray. Amen. Our scripture passage today is from Luke chapter 10, beginning at the 25th verse. On one occasion, an expert in the law stood up to test Jesus. "Teacher," he asked, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" "What is written in the law?" he replied. "How do you read it?" He answered, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself." You have answered correctly, Jesus replied. Do this, and you will live. Sisters and brothers in Christ, grace and peace to you from God our Father, from our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Jesus is asked something over 300 questions in the gospel. He gives a straight answer to fewer than 10 of those questions. In this passage that we just read from Luke chapter 10, an expert in the Jewish law, meaning the 613 commandments of the Old Testament, plus probably the Pharisees' additional rules which related to keeping ritually pure, well, this expert in the law asks Jesus a question. And Jesus just asks him one right back. Some people interpret this passage as indicating that maybe he was hostile to Jesus, maybe trying to set a trap, like we see in some other interactions Jesus has with some Pharisees and some Sadducees. But the way this conversation plays out, it seems like it was a genuine question. By this point in Jesus' ministry, he's made some pretty big claims about himself, and it seems as if this legal expert is genuinely trying to see if Jesus is legit or not. He asks, "What must I do to inherit eternal life?" We American Christians probably hear that as, "How do I go to heaven when I die?" But that's probably not what this legal expert meant. You see, many first century Jews expected that there would be a resurrection on what they sometimes called the last day or the day of the Lord. Now, although the Old Testament term day of the Lord could apply to any and every day on which God acted decisively in one way or another in human history, they were looking for a time in which God would act both decisively and finally, like one more time, God's going to put everything right. And on that final day, they believed the righteous would be raised. So this expert in the law is probably asking what he has to do to be in the final resurrection. What he has to do to keep covenant, to live within the covenants that God made with Abraham and with Moses, so that he would be one of the people who would be deemed to be faithful and would be raised. Now, we should realize that Jesus elsewhere redefines this question. Jesus himself brings the new covenant. That's the same word actually as the New Testament. And Jesus brings the kingdom of God, and Jesus brings eternal life. In fact, the terms kingdom of God, kingdom of heaven, and eternal life seem to be used interchangeably by the gospel writers, although John uses the term eternal life more than the other gospels. But here that phrase, eternal life, shows up in Luke. Now, I have a question for you. When did eternity start? When does it end? Are we in eternity now? If we think of eternity as an infinite line in both directions, are we on the line? Well, yes. Today is part of eternity. So eternal life can include life today because today is part of eternity. We often talk about eternal life like it starts after we die. But eternity includes today. And if Jesus makes the kingdom available to us today, because Jesus did come bringing the kingdom of God, eternal life can include today. The question is whether we're living in relationship with the eternal God, whether we're living in the kingdom and, with God's help, striving to live by God's values. You notice that Jesus doesn't answer this guy's question, does he? Instead, he asks one back. So you're an expert in the law. What does the law say, and how do you interpret it? The second part of this question, how do you interpret it, acknowledges that maybe there's not a simple and obviously correct answer. In fact, this question had been debated for generations. How did this lawyer understand it? And it does seem that this lawyer already knew the answer to his own question. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, your soul, your strength, and your mind. Love your neighbor as yourself. The four qualifying phrases referring to heart, soul, strength, and mind collectively indicate the whole person. Love the Lord your God with your whole person. God's claim on our lives reaches to every area of our experience, to our innermost being, our identity, our resources, and our intellectual capacities. No part of ourselves is to be withheld from God or offered to somebody or something else. In the other Gospels, Jesus quotes these Old Testament passages, but here, the lawyer answers Jesus' question with them. Similar language shows up in Matthew and Mark's Gospels, and it quotes or paraphrases from the Shema, a passage in Deuteronomy 6 that begins with, "Hear, O Israel," and includes the command to love the Lord. It also quotes from Leviticus chapter 19, verse 18, the commandment to love your neighbor. There are 613 commandments in the Old Testament. We tend to focus on 10 of them, but these two commandments, love the Lord and love your neighbor as yourself, are a pretty good summary of the entire set. This is how you live. If you're guided by the idea that you will love the Lord and you will love your neighbor, the rest is detail. What is implied here, though, is actually three commands. Love the Lord, love your neighbor, and love yourself. Because if you don't love yourself on some level, if you don't take care of yourself, you can't really take care of or love others. I'm sure some of you remember Gale Sayers, the great running back who played for the Chicago Bears. He wrote a book called I Am Third. Now, before I had read the book, I thought he was talking about maybe having the third most rushing yards in history or the third most touchdowns in a season or something like that. But he was actually quoting from a plaque he had seen on someone's desk, inspired by this biblical passage. The plaque said, "God is first, others are second, and I am third." And Gale Sayers wrote that he tried to live his life in that way. So if God is first, others are second, and I am third, it's not about me. To which I can only reply, darn it. Right? See, that's really contrary to our culture's emphasis on individualism, isn't it? Our culture encourages each one of us to think of ourselves as a rugged individual, going through the world and imposing our will on reality and on other people. But the Christian ethic, as understood by these commandments, read through Philippians chapter 2, where we are encouraged to sacrifice for others just as Christ sacrificed himself for us. It's to put both God and other people ahead of ourselves. The Barbie movie comes out this weekend. I haven't watched it. I don't know if I will. But someone sent me a blog post that said that Ken represents Jesus and Barbie represents God in the movie. I really did not understand the blogger's logic. But if Ken is sacrificing his own interests for Barbie's sake, and that's what this blogger was trying to get at, and I'm assuming it's correct because I haven't seen the movie. If Ken is sacrificing his own interests for Barbie's sake, I suspect that Ken represents Jesus and Barbie represents humanity. And we're called to sacrifice our own interests for the interests of others, just as Jesus sacrificed himself for us. And this is not at all the way our culture, our society encourages us to live. I spent last week with friends from my college years. Friday night, we played a house concert, and afterwards, we were visiting with another friend from Luther College, and the philosopher Bertrand Russell came up. I'm sure he comes up in everybody's discussions all the time, but he did in ours. Russell once said, and I'll paraphrase here, that our culture encourages us to think that if something is good for us, it must be good for the whole world. And he went on to say that we need to turn that around and think that if something is good for the world, then it must be good for us too. God is first, others are second, I'm third. It's not about me. The story isn't about me. It's also not about us, meaning the church, especially when resources are tight. It's easy to make it about us. In this materialistic, secular, individualistic culture, especially at a time when many churches are shrinking, we're tempted to focus on whether we have enough resources to survive. And those are important questions. But the story is not about us. It's about the good news, what God has done for us in Jesus, and then responding by loving God and loving our neighbors. God is always the star of this story. It's what Jesus did for us is the focal point of the story. If we're focused too much on our own survival, we can start to think that it's up to us to solve our own problems, and we can even make the church into an idol. And we can try to turn God into a product that we think we can own or control, then dole out to people we think of as our customers or our clients. And that's not the good news. This way of thinking, which we may well be guilty of without even being aware that we're doing it, downplays or ignores the fact that, as Swiss theologian Karl Barth reminded us, God is God, which means that you're not God, I'm not God, and the church isn't God. It's God who is God, and it's God who took the initiative to love the world and send Jesus into the world. But this way of thinking, ignoring the fact that God is God and trying to be the star of our own story, may tempt us to focus so much on the church's story that we neglect the story of what God did to save us, and for that matter, what God is doing in the world today. Or it could make us think that we can control God rather than simply meet and experience the presence of the God who saves us through paradox, through acknowledging our own doubts, through confession and worship. Let's look at Ephesians chapter 2, beginning at the 8th verse. Paul writes, "For it is by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not from yourselves, it is a gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do." This famous passage reminds us that our real problem, our biggest problem, is that we are separated from God by our own sin, our own mess-uppedness, this power that wants us separated from God, our self-centeredness and our pride. But when we confess that we can't save ourselves, we can receive by faith the gift of God. We often quote verses 8 and 9, but then we also often stop before we get to verse 10. "For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. In other words, you've been saved for the purpose of doing good works, doing good stuff. Now, I almost hesitate to say this because it's easy to confuse with this with the idea that maybe you're saved by doing the good works. But that's not what Paul says here. Paul says that you're saved and then you are made a new creation in Jesus Christ for the purpose of doing good. Martin Luther, who didn't mean to start a new church and unfortunately sometimes seemed to be regarded as highly as Paul or even as Jesus, argues that our response to being saved is to love and serve God and love and serve each other, which is, of course, what Jesus says and what Paul is saying here. This "you" applies to Christ followers individually, and it applies to the church as a whole. You and we as the whole church are saved for the purpose of doing good works, of doing God's work in the world. The verb that is often translated as doing is peripateo. It literally means walking. So we are saved for the purpose, Paul says, of walking in good works. And walking refers to how we orient our lives. Are we walking in the ways of our culture, in the elevation of ourself above everything and everyone else? Or are we walking in the way of Jesus? Are we following Christ? Are we seeking out and doing the good work that God prepares for us, which can be summarized, in short, as loving God and loving our neighbors? Again, reminding us that it's not about me or us. It's about God's love for us. It's about God's love for the world and what Jesus Christ has done for us by going to the cross, dying, and then rising to save us from everything that would keep us separate from God and from our neighbors. The story, the good news, is about God acting in the world for the sake of the world. God is always the primary actor, the one who saves and redeems us. Salvation, what Paul elsewhere calls justification or being made right with God, is a free gift because Jesus Christ humbled himself for us. But when we receive that free gift, we're called to act for the sake of the world that God loves, to do good works, to love God and to love our neighbors. The works don't save us, but they are an outgrowth of faith. Eternal life, connected to the eternal God today, and eternal life with God after our physical deaths, is not something that we earn by keeping God's commands perfectly. It is what we receive by God's grace through faith in Jesus. When we come to faith, having been saved by God's grace, we are made a new creation and empowered to love and serve God and each other. Please join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for sending Jesus to save us because we cannot save ourselves. Forgive us for the times that we are self-centered, for the times that we try to make ourselves or anything else an idol. And then, having forgiven us, make us new and help us to love you and help us to love our neighbors. Help us to serve this world that you love. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Now I invite you to join me as we confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And now for our love moment, we have a video about Camp Agape.
Who am I? How can I help these kids? I've never experienced a parent incarcerated growing up. But I realize that I don't have to go through that exact experience to make a difference in these children's lives.
It's a great camp. Good to know kids are just like you.
There are some people who could relate to me. Tell me what my mom, my family, you know, getting through the fact that we don't have our dad.
All five of my siblings have gone to this camp. I just see the joy that they feel when they're here. I know that God gave us that joy.
That's what Camp Agape is about, is helping these kids find empowerment with the adults, with the other kids, but most importantly, with Jesus himself.
The transformation of the kids, it is amazing.
Every year it changes me even more.
I have never worked with people who are more passionate about doing jobs that no one will ever know got done.
55 years old, I've done a lot of ministry in my life. I've had the toys and the material stuff, but there's no greater joy in life than seeing a transformer.
This year, our Vacation Bible School supported Camp Agape for their Love Project. Camp Agape California has a mission of reaching out to and giving as many children of incarcerated parents as possible an opportunity to attend a four-day summer camp and a winter camp each year. We'll be collecting both items and money until August 13 to help with this project. Please help contribute to this and make it possible for these children with incarcerated parents to attend camp. In Matthew chapter 6, we read, "Do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy, and where thieves break in and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moth nor rust destroys, and where thieves do not break in and steal." We get to live in the kingdom of God, what Matthew calls the kingdom of heaven on this earth, in this life, when we are connected to God's love, which then allows us to share that love with others. We strive to share God's love, changing lives for the sake of the gospel. You can give to Messiah in a wide variety of ways. Thanks for your generous gifts in support of Messiah and our ministry of loving God and loving one another. Please join me in prayer. Holy God, you are rich in mercy. By the humiliation of your Son, you lifted up this fallen world and rescued us from the hopelessness of death. You save us and make us new every day. Lead us into your light. Lead us into your life. Lead us into your love, so that all of our works will proclaim your love for the world. You are gracious and merciful, and your love endures forever. You bring forth food from the earth, and you nourish your whole creation. We ask that you turn our hearts toward those who hunger in any way, so that all may know your love and your care. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let's join in the prayer that our Lord taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Now let's sing our sending song.
Your promise is my confidence, is your faithfulness, and I will rest in your promise.
Receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you with grace and with mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace. Serve the Lord with joy. Thanks be to God.